Hey, what's up, everybody? We're here in San Gabriel to celebrate the 10-year anniversary of Mariachi El Bronx II. Come take a walk with us down memory lane.
How you doing, man? Yeah, what's up, bro? It's good to see you, bro.
Your hair's hotter than mine, bro.
Love you guys, man.
Good to be back.
Oh, my God. This is like deja vu all over again.
It looks great.
You guys look the same, everything.
Let's dive into 2008, then. Let's do that. Because El Bronx started in 2007-08. We're writing, messing around different songs, and we had enough songs to make a record, but the search for a producer, someone to record it, was long and arduous. We couldn't find anybody.
No. And we didn't even have really a band. And Brad came, I remember that was right when Brad joined the band. Gonna do this mariachi record. You can play trumpet. All right, here, play along to this song. He's like, I don't think I've played trumpet in 10 years. So I'm like, oh, sounds great. Here in the band.
Yeah, we had a friend of the band say, hey, I think I've got the guy for you.
It's Jonathan Daniel.
Yeah, it's Jonathan Daniel, and you know, he said, I think I got the guy for you.
Yeah.
John Avila. Yeah, you know, he used to play bass in Oingo Boingo. He's an insane musician, great guy. I think it's going to be a perfect fit.
He booked, it might have been Food for Feet, or one of your bands at Madame Walks.
Wow. That was like our first gig.
Now he manages the acts that Ray plays with. Lord, and you know, all that stuff.
Yeah, that's
crazy. Small world.
Small world. And yeah, the first record kind of like, it really flew by, but it was one of those things, I think for all of us, it was, you know, super organic, inspiring, and just an incredible experience here in Brando's paradise. When did you open this studio? Well, this is your house, basically.
This is my house, and this used to be my garage, and it used to be, like, it started up just as a rehearsal place to make noise. And I when Oingo Boingo ended, in 95, I had been touring by that time for, I'd never done anything but tour to make a living since high school. And I was already getting close to my 40s, and I'm like, man, I'd like to stay home. My kids are still pretty little. I want to stay home a little bit. And I had, luckily enough, Danny Elfman had asked me to co-produce the Oingo Boingo records with him and Steve Bartek, so I was part of the production team. And that's where I learned production and working in nothing but major studios with incredible engineers. So I was always watching and taking notes and da-da-da, and I started, you know, collecting little pieces of gear here and there. And when Oingo Boingo ended, I said, I'm going to try this. I'm going to start building my little studio. And I remember started with a little 4-track Porta studio, and then I went to 8-track, and then I went to 16-track, and little by little, it's getting a little better. And then things started to develop.
Awesome, man.
And then you guys came along.
What were your first impressions when we actually got here and we started doing the first record?
One of the things that really impressed me about you guys, I knew you guys were great songwriters. That was immediate. I was like, man, these guys, they've been to this dance. You guys know how to write songs. So that was, you know, took a lot of the worries of that. But I remember we went to your studio.
Yeah, we did the pre-production.
And you guys had this amazing studio. And I'm like looking around, it was like multi-million dollar control room,
yeah,
and you guys
say that.
Well,
smoking mirrors, John. Smoking mirrors.
It was impressive, and I remember, and I remember asking Joby or and you guys, I was like, how come you guys don't want to record here? And you said, well, where did you do the Quetzal record? I remember you mentioned. I go, we really like the sound of that Quetzal record. I go, well, I did it at Brando's Paradise. He goes, well, that's where we want that sound. And so we want to do it at your place.
Yeah, that room is magical. Sounds killer.
Okay. So that impressed me, the fact that you, with this amazing room you guys had, you were going for the sound. So that was really cool.
Yeah. I remember we were so stoked after the first record. There was like the first time we had that balance of like, okay, now we're actually, we have El Bronx and we have Bronx. We were kind of faced with the, what do we want to do next? And it was pretty obvious from the get-go. We had such like momentum after the first record. We just kept writing songs. And it was like, we're going straight into record number two.
Super impressive that this, you know, hard rock band with a screaming singer could pull that off. And it wasn't even just pulling it off. I mean, somehow we made it work.
Yeah.
And I mean, one, we, you know, having really good songs. And I think also, too, having Vince with his incredible...
The glue.
With his background with your dad. And I think you were a big part also of making it sound the way it did. And then you becoming an incredible crooner. You could just, all of a sudden, man, this, I was like, this guy could sing, man.
It was such an amazing place to record because it was, I think everybody was in the same boat as far as like just trying something new. And we were all super supportive and it was such a great space here to record music and just try stuff. Big, the big addition to the group, Ray Swin here for record number two. And that was, I think the idea for the second record was to just take everything we learned for the first one and just like perfect it, you know what I mean? Just do it better. And I think honestly, I think we knocked it out of the park. And this is probably the, you know, most inspired I've ever been in my life is on this record. I think everybody just really played so good. I think the songs are great. Looking
Absolutely.
Back on it after 10 years, like we were just talking about, it fucking holds up, man. It's a great record.
Really is. Well, I have Revolution Girls, which used to be called Spanish Girls. That's what it's labeled as.
Yeah,
that's
the hunt. Right. That was the lyrical hunt, but that was like the last piece of the puzzle for that song. Was
I
like,
remember that.
We had blank girls, and Joby and I were all, it was...
I was like, we can't say Spanish Girls.
Yeah,
it's
a good
show. Horny.
It's a good show.
Yeah.
And you came up and you're like, what about Revolution Boulevard? And I was like, that was your idea.
Yeah. It was fucking dope. And that fit, Revolution, was just perfect. And that song, honestly, I mean, I remember that song, personally, for me, was so nerve-wracking because the first time I was singing so fucking high, I was so scared to do that, and it was, but it came out fucking great.
You know
what we did on fucking Letterman? It was just like, oh my God. Where did the guitar intro come from? Was that just...
I was gonna say, when did you write that one?
Because
I feel like that we were through, we'd started on a bunch of other stuff, but that came in.
It was one
like,
of the last songs.
Yeah,
it
was,
because I was trying to do that Jarocho shit that you know, with the, and I just couldn't use that Bua pick or comb or whatever
bone
the fuck it was, that bone thing.
The bone,
so
the bone.
Like, give it that bone.
That's not
what he came up with.
When you hear it on, like, this is just like a rough mix, but you can hear that line. It just drives the tune.
I don't particularly recall it. I just remember I was trying to do that stuff, and I couldn't. And so I was just, fuck, give me the guitar. So I would kind of, I tried to, like, pick it really hard and snap the strings to get that sound, and you know, that's my attempt or version of trying to play a rhythm.
Check it out.
I like
it. Right.
Yeah.
song was too long, so we had to cut it down.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
We cut
no,
a ton
right.
of that section out just to fit within our timeline. And then we always played it the same way since.
That's right.
Yeah.
Since I was 15 years old.
Oh, that's awesome.
And I wrote my first song on that guitar.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I remember when we were working on just pre-production, you always had that. That was the one. Always.
It's my little magic guitar. It's just like, things just seem to come to me easier when I play that guitar.
Yeah. It looks badass, too.
It's got the Willie Nelson thing going on. Yeah.
Trigger. That was fucking dope. Is it possible to,
yeah.
Can we get 48 up
on
here? Is that possible?
Oh, yeah, I got them all.
Little trumpet time.
Was 48 the first song that you wrote?
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds right.
I actually remember we were in Chicago on tour. I remember when we opened the track, like the demo that you sent us.
We were on tour with Bronx.
We were on tour in Chicago.
No, because I just moved out of the studio. I finally found my own place in Silver Lake or whatever, and it was just like underneath some old lady's house, and like my room, it was just like a room.
Right.
And I remember just doing everything on my laptop and shit. Because I think we were talking about like, we need a fast one. We need a ripper. And that was like the working title of that one.
I just remember we were in Chicago. It was cold as shit, and we were walking somewhere for some reason. And I remember we opened up and listened, and we were like, oh shit, Ray just...
Ray's bringing some heat!
Oh shit!
Yeah. I remember listening to it, you know that, what's the club we used to always play? The backstage?
Subterranean?
Double Door.
Yeah.
And we went to that basement, and we're listening to it.
Yeah, ended up being, an absolutely killer fucking song. Bad first song on the record, too,
yeah.
You know?
So
check it out.
where was your head at when we were doing this record?
Well, that's
this song specific.
Well, the upgrade from 1 to 2, the best part for me was Ray coming in, and we sat at our studio and basically wrote the parts together, which was cool because you know, the first album, it was we recorded everything and then you guys put the violins on later, whereas with that we demoed everything together, so everything kind of moved. But for this one, I remember you kind of had the idea, and then we just kept taking like stabs at it for the demo, and we figured it out. But of course, immediately I'm like, oh shit, a high C, like no big deal. which, you know, for some people that's not that big a deal. Keith, you know, obviously. But I was
high
never.
C, Keith.
I was
never.
I was
just beverage.
Yeah, I was never a big high range guy. So, you know, recording it was okay because obviously you're recording. But like, yeah, once we started playing that live, it was like. Oh shit!
Here we go.
Now it's you know we've done it so many times over the years that it's fine. But yeah, it's It's funny to like listen to it back too. It's like, oh shit, yeah.
And that's that high trumpet part.
Yeah,
right
there. Can we solo?
Goddamn guitar solo on this. I of course, never learned because.
It's gonna be my ringtone.
You could make that into a ringtone. I remember, like, I was shitting my pants because we were doing the first TV we ever did on this record was Jay Leno, mm-hmm. and I had to learn that solo, and I had no idea how to play it because Ray obviously wrote it and tracked it. All day long, I sat there,
up to the minute we played,
and I fucked it up every single. Because they do the practice tapings and it's funny because if you watch the footage of that performance, the first time I ever nailed that solo in my entire life was when we taped it. Guaranteed. Was the actual taping. And you can see this change in the band of like everyone's like, and then like after we get out of the solo, everyone's like, ah.
Man, only 8 million people are watching that.
Still to this day, I'm just like, solo is the bane of my existence. Every time it comes up, like my heart skips a beat.
The last day of pre-production.
Yes.
And we this is the last day. We were all sitting around, actually, just like this. And I remember you guys as there. And I had this song that I might have mentioned to one of you, or you guys knew about it. I got this song that I wouldn't show this to anyone else. You were the only one.
Years ago.
Yeah, I had written it 10 years earlier. Yeah. And it sat on a shelf. But it had no words. And I had been trying for years to write words for this song, but I thought it, musically, it really fit Mariachi El Bronx, the instrumentation. And I thought if any band could do a great job on this, it would be you guys. And I remember it was the last day of pre-production. We're all sitting around. So are there any more songs, guys? Any more songs? And I go, well, I got this one song. Oh, yeah, John, I remember you were talking about that song. Well, let's hear it. And you guys were all standing around looking at me like this, and I'm like, okay. And I pulled it out, and I had my charango. I think I had it on the charango.
Yeah.
And I start jamming it out, and I played the song, and I was humming the melody because I didn't have words. And then the song ended, and I remember there was silence, and you guys were just all looking at me, and then you guys all looking at each other, and they go, hell yeah, let's do that song.
Yeah.
And you guys just right there and said, yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, we did it. And it's like, I remember going back and writing like rough draft lyrics that night and bringing it back the next day. And then we were kind of just going over. And that song came together so cool. And that's one of the things that I love about this place and you and just this record and everything is just the way everything just naturally came together in such like a musical. Like, it was just beautiful. And I remember when we kind of first ran through the song together with lyrics and everyone kind of playing it, it was just an incredibly powerful moment. You know, it was super cool. And then we got the girls on backups on the song, too. And it sounds fucking killer.
That was the Rainer Girls, right?
Yeah.
Killer group.
Yeah, let's check it out. Check it out.
Well, you remember, you wrote those words in one night.
Yeah, it was, dude,
I literally came back the next day and go, oh, I got lyrics for that song. And I remember I was crying when you sang them to me. I was just like, they were so perfect.
Thank you, man. It was meant to be. It was, like I said, there's something about, you know, this group here that's just awesome.
Yeah.
Same wave.
And here's John's Jam.
That's what it was called.
Yeah, that's right.
Lost 7 days, we crawled up to the ground. Lost 7 sins, we were just like a crown. Angels will cry, and angels will moan. When will they leave us alone? Lord, this is my home.
Jesus. Can we isolate the the group vocals on the choruses?
You know what I remember about this song? I think we've only played it once.
No, we did it on that Tiny Desk.
We played it.
We played it a couple of times. I remember we did it at La Cita with you, John. You came down and played for our record release party. That was a fun night.
Let's check out the chorus vocals with all the backups and everything.
That's how I feel every time I see her.
She's good. I remember that. That was slapping two sticks on the kick drum.
Whoa, that's red. That sounds like me 10 years ago.
I think that's you too, John, right?
Yeah. We all. Damn.
That's so dope.
You know what's crazy? It's how the vibrato matches up with all those girls.
Yeah.
Like it wasn't.
It's like they know what they're doing.
It's like a drill though. Everybody was in the face paint, and we did like three songs, right?
That was Elvez.
With Elvez.
Yeah, the Tearaway Mariachi.
But we played El Gusto with those guys, and it was just like, oh shit, like we actually have to do a real thing now. We got a lot of mileage out of that thing, didn't we? I thought we only played it on a couple, like on one or two songs.
When did that guy, when was the guy?
No, Willie Acuna from Mariachi Soul. Yeah.
That's
because the next one I was like, well, we gotta have somebody who actually plays this thing now, and he took a ripping solo. This is just within my wheelhouse.
I still follow him on Instagram.
That guy's
sounds
so beautiful.
Yeah, we gotta get a harp. We gotta put a harp in here, like a standing house harp. Clouds, seven last words. No. Let's. That's you.
Nice bit. That sounds so dope.
I didn't realize there was a mistake in there.
Oh, we better go back and remix it.
Once everything is in there, it sounds better.
Afternoon or something like that.
Yeah,
I remember it came by really fast.
It came together pretty quick.
And we just kind of turned into like Guitarmageddon at the end. <everybody's old. laughs>
Yeah, because where is this on the album? It's like second to last or something. Right?
Might be last.
No, like B3. Spread thin.
It is
last.
Second to last. No, I remember that because that's the other one. I mean, those two songs on that record I always loved a lot too. Yeah.
All right, you good to go?
Let's see here.
10 years of Mariachi El Bronx II. This record means a lot to me. Probably, learned the most out of any recording experience that the Bronx or El Bronx has done. We traveled the world on this record. Did David Letterman, Jay Leno, Jimmy Kimmel. A lot of great memories and a lot of great songs. Happy anniversary.
Hello, my name is Joby, and I play in Mariachi El Bronx. This record was a really big turning point for myself and our band in many different ways. One, probably the most important, was we were all pushing each other musically to learn new instruments and to learn new ways of playing. And it was, I don't know if I want to say competitive, but it was definitely see who can learn, you know, whatever wild, new, crazy instrument. So that was a really great part of it. It also, it was the first time we, you know, ever got to do a bunch of the late night TV circuit, which doesn't exist anymore, which I feel super fortunate to do that. And it kind of really opened us up, you know, and kind of made us kind of the thing that we have now, the duality with the two different bands. And we, you know, we got to tour with some bands that we had, you know, no business being in arenas with or sharing the stage with at all. But there were some wonderful times, and it's so great to revisit some of these songs and the memories. And this record definitely changed the trajectory of my musical life and career, and along with my brothers in this band. I'm thankful to come back to where it all started, in a garage in San Gabriel.
Ready?
Yep.
Mariachi El Bronx II, released in 2011. This album means a lot. You know, it's a great album from beginning to end. I have a lot of memories working on it, recording here with John Avila at Brando's Paradise. I remember staying late in the cold recording room, recording my guitar, just, you know, trying to record a bell, you know, mariachi girls coming and singing. The sound is great on this album. It's a lot of memories. Great album. Please listen to it. Mariachi El Bronx 2.
Go ahead.
All right. Mariachi El Bronx 2. 10 years. Man, that's crazy. I don't know. Some of my favorite memories of this album, I think, like, early on, you know, after we did the first album, which was really cool. It was really stripped down. We were really kind of figuring out what we were doing. And I love that album. It's amazing. But I remember early on tracking this album and sitting in the room kind of at night, listen back to what we did that day, and just how everything came together, and the instrumentation and the things we added from the first album is just amazing. And one of my favorite parts was obviously adding Ray to the mix. And when we demoed this album, we demoed the horns and the violins together, so they coexisted and worked with one another. And kind of seeing that come together as a final product was always something that I think, I know I was always really proud about it, and it was something that Ray and I vibed back and forth with those parts a lot, which I think was a really cool step up from how we did the first album, which they're two different beasts, and I love them both, and I love that they're different like that, but I think that was cool. And then the only non-related, non-music story I want to tell is during that album, Vince kept getting a wrong phone number call. Like this lady would call Vince thinking she was calling her like brand new boyfriend, lover, whatever, and leaving these really weird like voicemails, and his name, the guy that she thought she was calling, his name was Bernstein, which made it even weirder. And she'd always be like, "Bernstein, you crossed my mind, what are you doing?" And I remember we always laughed at that. And he got like two or three of them. I think we recorded them, so we might even be able to dig those out somewhere. But anyways, this was a really awesome time for all of us musically. And I know for me as a horn player, coming back out from not playing for a while before we did the first album, by the time we got here, I was kind of back on the horse, and it felt good. And yeah, really proud about this one. So cheers. 10 years.
Hey, I'm Keith. I play trumpet in Mariachi El Bronx. I didn't have the pleasure of playing on this amazing album, but this is right when I joined the band. I remember being in the studio when they took this shot of Kellen from Trash Talk, and Han Solo did the bling for Joby. I remember when that stuff showed up, and we were getting ready to play Coachella, which was the first time we played songs off this record, and that was actually my first show in 2011. But the first club shows I ever did with them was the release at La Cita downtown, and John Avila got up there with us, and yeah, that was the beginning, man. I can't believe it's been 10 years, but been lucky enough to keep making music with these guys, and playing these tunes is always really special because I know what it meant to these guys. So Yeah, looking forward to making many more of them.
What is it? Buddy, gonna get a buddy.
Ten years. What a trip. Yeah. I don't know what to say. The thing that comes to mind is I left the band after the first record, and then they debuted the record and had the famous Carla Tovar playing, you know, bass on it, and she was amazing. When I saw her play, it made me want to join the band again, and so when she got busy again and I found out they were making this second record, I weaseled my way back in.
Well, oh man, this is wild, because I remember a lot about this record. I mean, I used to remember a lot more before I met these guys and they taught me how to drink, but like, it's crazy because I just moved to LA and I always had a bad attitude about LA. I'm from San Diego and like, this place was the enemy, but I met these guys and realized like, well, maybe it's not so bad. And for this to be the first experience that I had making a record while I was up here, when I just moved here, it really is nice to see, even though, you know, we're all in kind of different places now, it's nice to be able to come back and still for it to feel like, oh yeah, we did a lot of good work here, and it's nice to see everybody again, and like, man, yeah, it's a trip. especially when you haven't heard some of this stuff in a long time, it's really something to think about those times and everything we got done here, man. Yeah, I don't know. I didn't think I was going to feel this way about it, man, to be honest with you.
Cool, man.
My name's John Avila, and I'd like to say what an honor and a privilege to work with an incredible group, Mariachi El Bronx, who have done three albums here. And we have nothing but great memories of making music and creating art with great songs and the collaborative how we all pull together to make this incredible music. And Mariachi El Bronx are great guys, great songwriters, and I'm just so happy to have had them here at Brando's Paradise. And this music's gonna be around, because it just seems to, it's been 10 years since this album came out, and I can tell you, it's aging extremely well, and we got 10 and 10 and 10 and 10 more years for all the listening and enjoyment for this record. And I'd like to thank all these guys for letting me be a part of this.